Well, thank you all for coming. It's a beautiful day, and I'm sure a lot of you would rather be outside raking, playing in the dirt, but so I certainly appreciate everybody making the effort. So, a couple months ago, when we were trying to come up with what was, that was going to be our next series, we decided that the best is good, better, best. And for those of you who are sort of novices to this whole field, the patriarch, at least in our minds, of the American furniture world was a fellow by the name of Albert Sack, who is the son of Israel Sack. Israel Sack was a Lithuanian immigrant who came here probably just around the turn of the century, around 1900, 1905, and established in Boston the interest in American antiques. He was a Jewish Lithuanian immigrant who was taken in by the Yankee crowd in Boston, which was an accomplishment in his own, because he realized right off that there was great talent in 18th century cabinet making. He was trained as a cabinet maker in Lithuania, so he understood great craftsmen, cabinet making, and when he came here, he just thought that there was something really special about American arts and crafts, furniture especially, and so he established a business in Boston. And he was really the patriarch of American furniture. And so he started this business, eventually he had to go to New York City where there was more money, more interest, and he had three sons. And he went through the Depression, lost everything, was totally broke, and reestablished his business and became he really established what American furniture was and why it was so great. The man deserves so much credit. So his three sons, Harold, Albert, and Robert, in age, decide to follow him in the business. And Albert, the middle son, served in World War II and was actually in England when the war ended. And he came back just after the war, rejoined his father in the business, and started to spread his wings. And the three brothers each had their own part of the business. Harold was the financier. Israel Sack was not a financier at all. He was not a money guy. He just loved to buy and sell antiques. Harold became the brains of the finance. Albert became the bird dog. He even called himself the bird dog. He would travel all over, it didn't matter where it was, to chase down a great example of American furniture. Robert, the youngest, stayed in-house and took care of the logistics, the photography, the display, the ads, the pickup, the delivery, all the things that go on in the background that makes a business successful. So Albert decided that there had to be sort of a little bit of a lesson for most people of how to judge American furniture. So he came up with this idea of a book called Good, Better, Best. And in 1950, he wrote his first edition. He and my father were the closest of friends. They were probably closer than brothers. So I was very lucky to be raised by two fathers, Albert being almost my surrogate father. We were very close. He died last year. And the ADA, Antique Deal Association, had a tribute to him in January in New York City. The man was a genius. He had an incredible eye. He had a great knowledge of the English language, could write really well. He wrote great poetry. And he was a man of great talents. So he decided to write this book, Fine Points of Furniture, Early American, and that's what established Good, Better, Best. And it became this really amazing, because it's gone through so many printings. It's weighed probably over 25 or 30 printings now. And you can relate it to life, because whether you're buying a car, whether you're buying your shirt, or women are buying a pair of shoes, you know, there's always the good, there's the better, and the best. And the best... and wives too. And so that's how the whole idea got started, and still to this day, I think it's a great lesson in life. So I'm just going to tell you a couple of funny stories, because my father and Albert were so close and so very similar in personalities that there's a few family stories. The first story goes about when Albert printed this book, and he arrives in Colchester to come and see my father, and he was wearing a incredibly bright plaid long overcoat that almost dragged on the floor. Albert was not a man of fashion at all. It was so out of his realm that he could care less what he was wearing. All he was doing was pursuing great examples of American furniture. So he arrives this one day with this long coat, very bright plaid, and my father saw him and said, "My God, what are you wearing?" He said, "I'm an important publisher now. I'm a writer, and I have to dress the part." And he wore this coat around, and everybody laughed at him until finally he had to take it off. But
he reminds me of my husband.
And then one day, Albert came to a family party that we had. I think it was one of our daughter's wedding, or maybe her bas mitzvah. I don't know. I don't remember. But he had stayed overnight at my father's house. And the next morning, he came down, because he didn't sleep. He was a guy who would sleep maybe 3 hours a night. And he came down, and my stepmother was in the kitchen. And Albert was my height, my size. My father was considerably bigger. So he comes down in the kitchen first thing in the morning, and he says to my stepmother, "Joanna, I don't know what the hell my wife bought me, but my jacket is way too big. I don't know what happened. I don't understand." And the jacket was way too long. It was down to here. The sleeves are down to here. My father arrives, comes downstairs in the kitchen, and he said, "God damn it, Joanna, what'd you do? You shrink my jacket?" He was wearing Albert's, and Albert was wearing my father. Neither one of them figured it out. I mean, that was a really perfect example of what these guys were like. They were totally focused on this stuff, and the rest of the world was going around them. They could care less what was going on. They were so myopic about what they did. And then there's another story that this was our daughter's wedding, and he was invited, he attended. And he arrived in the afternoon. The wedding was Saturday night, and with a blue blazer, gray slacks, and they decided it was time to get ready for the party on Saturday night. And he reaches into his sports jacket pocket, and he said, "What am I going to do with the box?" And my father said, "Well, what box is that?" He said, "Oh, the gold box." There was a very famous gold, solid gold box that was sold at Sotheby's for $500,000. He was carrying it loose in his sports jacket pocket, and he was taking it to somebody the next day in Boston for them to consider. And it was this very, very iconic, very famous box. He was carrying it loose around. So he said, my stepmother said, "What are we going to do with it? We just can't leave it in the house. Somebody will break in and steal your box." So Joanna comes up with this idea of taking the sour cream container, a cottage cheese container. She puts all the cottage cheese into a plastic bag, cleans it out, puts the gold box into the cottage cheese container, and puts it back into the refrigerator, and that's where that solid gold box spent the night. that's what kind of people these Albert and my father were. I mean, they were so on another wavelength. So anyway, what we're going to do today is we're just going to, because no matter if you're collecting antiques or you're, whatever it is you're buying, you're always faced with the different categories of, is it really good enough? Is it worth the money? What's the best next step up, or is it, is this too much? Should it be a little less? So that's where Albert got this idea of good, better, best. And then he came up with the theory, the next one, which was his next book, that's the new fine points of furniture, good, better, best, superior, and masterpiece. Because the good, better, best didn't even cover it. Because once he published his first book, he realized that there were other categories that he never even considered. The absolute masterpiece of all. And that had its own category. So the new one, which he published when he was in his 80s, is now really considered the Bible too. So, and here's the ironic thing. Today is Alvin's birthday. And we didn't even know that. He died last year at 96. He would have been 97 today. When we picked this date of having this this event today, and we did not even realize that today was his birthday, and his son, Donald, lives in Pennsylvania, called up and said, did you really know that it was, Saturday was my father's birthday? So after this is over, we have a birthday cake for Albert that you're all welcome to share. So, Kevin Tulumeri, we'll take over.
Well, just a little bit to add, and I always enjoy hearing Arthur's stories about Zeke and Albert, and two guys near and dear to my heart, and just you, when you were around them, you could really feel that enthusiasm for Americana. It really came alive, and one of Albert's great gifts was his straightforwardness. You know, he wasn't really a man of details of which sports coat he was supposed to be wearing, but he had this enthusiasm and this ability to go straight to the matter, especially when it relates to antiques. And part of my favorite, one of my favorite parts of the Albert's book are the foreword by his father, Israel Sack, and the introduction by Albert himself. And they just really convey that sense of excitement and that sense of real enthusiasm for early American antiques and the qualities that they represented and the ideas that they represented of early American freedom and democracy. And this was really important to people and collectors early on that time, and I think it is still important to consider. When you read the introduction by Albert, it starts with the this great little quote that I put on our agenda, you're welcome to some, and it says, there's been so much hocus pocus written about the world of antiques over the years. And that was kind of an Albert thing to say. You know, he was going right to the matter. He wanted truth, he wanted reality, he didn't want, florid language. He wanted stuff, the facts, and he wanted to really convey the sense of beauty. And what really Albert really touched on in his great goal was that he really defined this term of comparative looking. And it's just that visual, simple approach of how to compare one object to the other. And when you really start walking down that road, you really get into some exciting experiences as you're starting to discover the subtle differences of form and carving and proportion, condition and history and all these great little details and minute aspects of Americana. But it really started with Albert's, straightforwardness and his ability to see an object for what it was.
So if you have any questions, yeah.
Sure. Can you give us a rough idea of what percentage of a group would fall into those categories? Is it like 50% good and 30% better? And does that change for different items like tables versus chairs versus clocks? Is that going to be different?
I would bet you that the percentage would be pretty consistent. Don't forget, it's a subjective.
Right.
It's a totally subjective field. You know, what we see as, say, better, somebody might say, is good. You know, actually, there are some people used to say about Israel Sack, the three categories was good, better, and in stock.
That's true.
In other words, if they had it, they were selling it, it had to be the best. So, that's people still say, if they want to be a little sarcastic about the business and about the Sack firm, good, better, and stock. But, when you think about it, it takes somebody with that little extra bit of imagination, that little bit of creativity that puts you over the edge, that makes it a little better. You know, it's, I don't care if it could be in the corporate world, in an office space where 100 people are working, there's going to be that 2 or 3% of the people who just have that little extra something, and you know it. You know it when you meet them. You know, when they walk in the room, there's just something special about them. The big part of us, you know, probably lay in the middle. You know, so we're trying to do our best, but we didn't have that little extra bit that would put us over the edge. And then there's the ones at the bottom who are always there. And just like they couldn't create a Windsor chair to be the best if they had to. They just didn't know what it took to get there. So I think, you know, it's what makes Derek Jeter a great shortstop. And the other guys maybe not so great. Just that little bit of difference. You know, it's...
But are we talking, say, when you say the best, top
5%? The best, the best to me...
10%?
30%?
Oh, I wouldn't even say 30. I would say, you know, maybe 20. 20% is the best. And then the masterpiece, maybe 5. And but part of that also is condition. And that had nothing to do with the cabinet maker or the person, the artist who painted it. It's the life it led since it was made. If it was really appreciated and really taken care of and it survived in great condition, that adds so much to the greatness, the masterpiece quality of it.
The history of it?
The history
of it. Well, certainly an important
I mean, you could have a masterpiece that started out, but if it was beat up, if it was refinished, if it was repainted, if the painting, if they didn't like the smile on her face and they changed her, these all contribute to the degradation of the masterpiece. Maybe you drop it down to the great. So it's a lot depends on other factors, not necessarily who created it, the day it was created, the conception of it. So it's all part of, you know, that formula at the end product of today, how we weigh it today. And you can, you know, that's what makes the race. That's why certain people will buy a Honda and certain people will buy a Chevrolet. They see a little difference in it that, you know, that you may not see, and vice versa.
And we put together a little list. I forgot my agenda if Kate can bring one up. We put together a little list of different issues that you want to consider as you're going through the process of what will make a, thank you, Kate, make it, you know, what you're going to consider as you're looking at an object. And we always start with form. Form first. And for us, when you look at an antique, first thing you see is the proportions, the form, how the crest matches with the back splat, matches with the legs. And these 18th century cabinet makers really worked on a sense of classical proportions. And they were tied to the Greeks and the Romans. And this is what they wanted. This is what the ideal of proportions, classical, nice, relaxing. When you look at different objects, you'll be able to see how those proportions relate to each other. So form is really for us the number one important indicator when you're comparing objects. There's carving and decoration. Condition we have as number 3, could easily be number 2 or number 1. Condition is so important, as Arthur was saying. Rarity has an incredible influence on value, also on the quality of the piece, and then historical significance. And you can literally have two chest of drawers, one owned by John Hancock and one not, and guess which one's going to be the masterpiece. You know, this one is owned by John Hancock. It goes into a different level of being. But those are the kind of things you want to consider as you're looking at it. And it's really, that's kind of Albert's genius. It's a straightforward process. It's a conversation between you and the object. You know, how does it look? What is it telling me? How's the top? How's the base? How's the legs? You know, that's the kind of the exciting part of the process that you go through.
So we're going to start because we're going to cover clocks, stands, portraits, and pipe boxes. And we'll, you know, we'll do this quickly, but we want you to see sort of a little bit of what's involved when we look at something, you know, and what excites us or disappoints us. So we're going to be going from right to left. Okay, these three clocks. And this was made by Levi and Abel Hutchins of Concord, New Hampshire. It is a straightforward, really nice clock. Now, these are brass movements. They run for 8 days, and they were very expensive when they were made. You were actually taxed on if you had a tall clock in your house, a brass movement tall clock, or if you had a pocket watch. Those were the two possessions that you would have been taxed on because they were very expensive, just like if you have an expensive car in your driveway. You're going to pay a lot more than the guy next door who has an inexpensive 23-year-old Volvo station wagon, Junior. So this is a painted dial, and it runs. It'd be perfect time. It is a cherry case, and it's pretty much all original. When I say pretty much, these two columns are replaced, and the finials, the brass finials, are replaced. As soon as you have replacements, it sort of hurts the battery, degrades it a little bit, because it's not perfect anymore. But the rest of it is. But it's simple. It's a very simple clock. There are people who do not want a fancy clock, still to this day. They don't want carvings. They don't want inlay. They don't want fancier feet. They don't want mahogany. There are still people today that are very happy with just a cherry case. They wouldn't buy this. They want this. But if we had to judge this, good, better, best, this is good. This is better. This has a inlaid case. You're welcome to come up here later and look at it. But in order for a cabinet maker to make this clock case, it took a lot more time. First of all, he had to get the mahogany imported from Santo Domingo, Honduras, Cuba. That was really expensive to get really good mahogany here in the colonies in the 18th century by boat. This is local wood. It just went out and saw it up to the sawmill and got a pile of wood, and they were in business. This was made by William Cummings, who was a very good maker right around 1800. These three clocks were almost made within 20 years of each other. This one being made right around 1800. This one the same. And that one's dated 1817. So see how stately this is? This one's a little sort of squattier in form. It doesn't have, you know, it's sort of like women fashion. Most of the models are 6 foot tall. The taller and slender, it gives a stately appearance. It's not squatty like me. I mean, I would never do that well on the runway. But that's what was more elegant. And so they accomplish the same thing. They keep the same time. They both run for 8 days. They're both brass movements. But the quality of the movements certainly changed from a really good clock maker who did all this work himself. These were all made, for the most part, by hand-filing brass files. Just think, they're still running. They are weight-driven with a pendulum. If you can see in there, and see the pendulum swing. Simple, and they're still running. They still keep perfect time. And all you have to do is wind it once a week, and it goes for another week. Simple, but amazingly successful. And so I'm going to let Kevin talk about that, which is the masterpiece. This is good, this is better. We don't even have a best, but that's a masterpiece. And he'll tell you why.
Sure, and before we leave the two clocks, this to me, the two clocks on the right are the epitome of Albert's comparative looking technique. These were both Levi and Abel Hutchins and William Cummins. All three were apprentices of Simon Willard in Roxbury, Massachusetts. And both of their case designs are based on the style of case that was popular in Roxbury and made by Simon Willard. But you can really see the subtle and not so subtle differences of the materials and proportions and quality of wood and brass and other details that go into making this. Clock on the left, a better example, but when you look at the fretwork, it's almost exactly the same, right out of the same template. And go up and look closely at the dials. The dials, I'm sure, came from the same manufacturer, probably in England. It looks like they could have been painted days apart. And it's really incredible the similarities that I realized myself when we just put these two clocks together. It was a little bit startling to me. But that really gives you that process of comparing the details of one object to the details of another, that how you learn about the integrity and the beauty and how to analyze these objects.
I'm going to add something about Kevin. The cabinet maker, the clock maker only made the movements, and he would order the cases from the local cabinet maker. And on this particular clock, on the back, it's written in chalk, which cabinet makers use almost exclusively. They use chalk, it's indelible. It says on the back, Cummins. So he was making this clock for William Cummins. He didn't want to get it mixed up with the guy down the street. So he actually wrote Cummins' name in there to make sure that he didn't get the cases mixed up. That is, that little bit, believe it or not, adds a fair amount to the value because it has a little bit of the history which you saw on your sheet. That little bit of provenance makes a difference.
And then we come to this tall clock by Asa Munger of Herkimer, New York, and it's dated on the dial 1817. And one of the first things that you realize about this clock, whether you're looking at the dial where there's three winding arbors, or you look inside and you notice there's three weights, as opposed to the time and strike clock, most clocks have two weights. As soon as you see a three-weighted clock, get very excited. This is really something special. This is actually an American musical clock, and it plays a song on every 3 hours. And there's only about 60 American musical clocks that have survived today. They're really special, they're really rare, and Arthur will activate the music. It's just one of these sounds that you don't hear very often.
That's going to run for about a minute. It's a long song. This is not the Rolling Stones. It was the Rolling Stones of 1817. You're welcome to come up here later and look at the movement. It's amazing. It's like a music box with a big roller, but there's 7 songs on that roller. And it changes every day on its own.
And so this song is called China, and you have the song indicator hand at the top, and it switches every once a day, which is really incredible on its own. It has a day of the week indicator, as well as a day of the month indicator, and the second hand that coils around the top, very unusual, is a coiled snake with the little copper or brass eye and a little ring on its neck. And the hands are gilt brass, and they have little rings with thistles on the inside. And this clock was given by Asa Munger to his daughter on her wedding in 1817. And it descended directly down through her family and has a really great family history. The backboard is inscribed with the name of a family member for the 19th century. So you can really trace this clock as it came down through time. And now the quality and the condition has survived really well. And the design of the case is a very desirable design, using the combination of curly maple and cherry for the clock case to give a contrasting wood and give a real kind of light and informal look to a very tall and formal clock. That combination of wood is typical for New York State, where Herkimer is, but really does add a nice element of decoration to the clock.
Is there a reason the weights are different sizes in all three clocks? I noticed they're all different, but is that just the decision of the clockmaker?
It's the way the clockmaker engineered the gears. You know, it's like a car. Yeah. Certain cars need a little more horsepower. And so, in this particular virtual, the weight on the right side always drives the time, and the weight on the left drives the bell. If somebody buys a clock and they don't want to hear it ring, so you'll hear when the week gets to 3 o'clock, it's going to ring three. That's driven by this weight. And in that particular clock with three weights, one weight drives the music.
What's interesting on this weight, someone decided it didn't have enough weight. So later on in its life, they added an extra piece of lead on the bottom and used these funny metal loops that hang it onto the weight. This is, I believe, the music weight. So if you would add more weight, it would make it kind of hit the bell harder. So that's part of the reason why they would do that.
Yes?
If the Asa Munger clock had a standard movement, say exactly the same as the one behind you, would it still be the best, or?
No.
That would be close, yeah.
No. Yeah. Well, just
I mean,
because
looking at the case, I think I kind of like that case better. Yes. So.
Well, it's entirely, that one has a combination of figured maple and cherry, right. But this one is a much more elegant case. But the difference in the value and the quality is the musical movement. It probably took Asa Munger at least 6 months to make that movement. You know, we've talked to enough people who know about clock making and clock repair, and they said it's so, the engineering, the math is so complex, and that's the only one that exists by him. He was a known clockmaker, but there is nothing even close to what he made that day for his daughter. And, yes?
How would these have compared when they were made in terms of value? Do they, their current, you know, valuations, are they reflective of how they would have
okay.
been when they were
My
made?
Father and I had the most incredible luck one day. We found the only known Simon Willard musical clock that exists. He was probably the Picasso. He was the household name of clockmaking at the time. And we actually found that clock in New London. And it was descended down through John Adams' family. And it's now in the Willard Clock Museum in Roxbury, Massachusetts. There is a label that goes on certain, it's a known label that are found on Willard clocks. And he actually lists the clocks that he made and what he charged for them. An average tall clock like this one was around $20 to $25. A musical clock was $100 or $120. There's only one that exists, and part of the reason is there's such complex movements that once they broke, nobody knew how to fix them, and they got tossed out. So nobody really knows how many were made, but they were very expensive. So if that clock was $20 and the musical one was $120, that's six times. So let's see. This clock is $48,000. This one is $225,000. So is that six times?
Six times.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that interesting? That's, you know, it's about six times. And we have actually, our family, have owned seven musical clocks of the 60 or 70 known to exist through our years. And they're either in museums or they're in great collections. That is really scarce to even have a musical clock available.
Yeah.
people come in here and say, this is like a museum. I said, it's better. You can buy it here. Try to go to the Athenaeum in Hartford and buy something off their floor. Take a half and deliver it. Yes?
What is the reason of having Roman numbers?
It was just a style.
Yeah, but is that a period in time?
Yes. The Arabic numbers came later. The Roman numerals were earlier. But the Arabic, and that's, you can see the Arabic numbers on this clock because this is 1817. These two are about just about 1800. So during that 15-20 year period, they started going to the Arabic numbers.
And that actually may relate to the earlier clocks, which were engraved brass dials. And it would be much simpler to engrave Roman numerals yes. than try to engrave the curves of the Arabic numbers. And the earliest clocks have either no numbers or Roman numerals.
Okay, so we'll move on to portraits. And there again, good, better, best. And so this is a portrait of a guy from Middletown. And it says his name right here, Augustus Cook, Esquire, Middletown, Connecticut. So he was an attorney in Middletown, probably just about, we turn it around, and lo and behold, painted by William Gurley Brown, and that's October 11th, 1842. So the really wonderful thing is we know who the portrait is of, who painted it, and it's all original. And so, and he's an attorney, and if you wanted to, you could probably find a lot about him, because at that time, pretty good record keeping by town halls, and there's a lot of records probably that are available. So that is a portrait. He's pretty proud of himself, pretty proud of the fact that he made himself an attorney. He's got a pen, a feather pen, which is the symbol of being an attorney. There are actually weather vanes that are just feathers. That's because the weather vane would be over the law office. That was the symbol of somebody who was educated and probably an attorney. So that is good. Okay, it's a nice, good portrait done by a very proficient artist, not a great artist. Then again, in Middletown, this is a sea captain. And I'll hold this one, and Kevin can speak on this one.
Okay, and this is Captain Stephen Clay of Middletown, Connecticut. And it's the only known portrait of a sea captain from Middletown. It makes it quite rare. And he's painted by an artist. We can tell from the style. Actually, he was also signed, although the back has been relined. This portrait is very well documented and was painted by the artist William Jennis. And it's documented in a very important reference book called The Great River. And that was a show at the Wadsworth Athenaeum back in the 80s. And so he's very well documented. The signature, which no longer exists, is also well documented. And he's just a really nice portrait, a very stately, successful gentleman in his 18th century clothes with his ruffled shirt, ruffled wristband, with his ship in the background. In good condition, you know, great provenance, great history. The importance of the sitter, the importance of the artist, and frankly, the quality of the artist. Jennis kind of captured the realism of Captain Clay's face a little better than William Gurley Brown captured Mr. Cook here. Mr. Cook's a little bit flatter. You don't quite have the roundness and the subtleties of volume and shading that you get with the Jennis portrait. Jennis was known for using this gray underpaint, and that really helped bring out the light colors in his painting. But what has happened over time is that the gray underpaint has come through the paint that he used to create the portrait. So he does have this little bit of grayish pallor to him, which is not his normal complexion. Just the effects of age. But real, really nice quality portrait with a really good track record.
So this is better than Mr. Brown painted. And by the way, the portraits that we're comparing are sort of what we call folk portraits. We don't have any real formal portraits right now, but if you turn around at some point, there's a gal up on that far wall. She is considered an academic picture. That was done by somebody who was really professionally trained. We don't know who did her. Unfortunately, she's not signed. But whoever did it was probably maybe New York City, perhaps. She's wearing a very stylish empire dress of the period, made famous by Josephine. And her hair, everything about her shawl, even the frame on the picture, it all shows that she, or at least her parents, because she's pretty young in that picture, she may not have been married yet, had the money to have a really fine artist in probably New York City paint her portrait. So we're keeping our comparison to folk portraits because we don't have three really good examples of formal pictures. But she is really finely done, really exceptionally done. So the next one is this one. This is Best. This was done by a painter in New London. His name was Isaac Sheffield. And he pretty much only did portraits of sea captains in New London. That's what he's known for. There's not that many portraits known by him. They are scarcer than hell and very desirable because in the window behind him is a whole whaling scene, what is called cutting in. They would catch whales and then pull them up next to the bow of the ship. Then they would roll them like a log, and they would slice the blubber off, lift them up, cut them into pieces, put them into the vats, boil the fat down to oil, and that was their bounty, their trophy. And so in the background is a whole whaling scene. It is a little gory for those who find the hunting of whales unappealing, but at the time, that's what gave you light in your home. That's what gave you oil to oil your clocks. And so Isaac Sheffield is known for painting these portraits. There's probably less than 15 known by him. And this is probably a member of the Smith family because there were six brothers in the Smith family from New London. And his theory is that he painted every member of the Smith family. And there is one at the New Bedford Whaling Museum that is pretty much just like his brother there, member of the Smith family. So, and that is actually painted on a wood panel. And so that was done probably about 1840, almost the same age as 1842 of Mr. Brown, Gurley Brown portrait of the lawyer from Middletown. The value difference is almost 25 times because of the whaling scene, which is so romantic and idolized in our culture. You know, Scrimshaw, the whole whaling industry is made so important to New London and Mystic, Stonington, New Bedford, Nantucket. New Bedford was the whaling capital of the country, almost of the world. It brought in a huge amount of wealth, economy, and these captains lived like kings and could hire a really good portrait artist to do his portrait. So that is the best because it has survived in remarkable condition and it's totally untouched, and there's no doubt we know who painted it. The only thing is we're not exactly sure who the subject is, but we're pretty certain it's the Smith family. And so that is best. Yes?
You said the second one had been lined. Has the first one been cleaned?
No, it might have been cleaned lightly. You see, Kevin will turn this one over. What happens is the canvas, you know, like you think of fabric, everything expands and contracts with time. Wood, even steel on a bridge. You go across bridges, and on the bridge you come, those expansion joints. Everything expands and contracts. The canvas expands and contracts at a different quotient than the stretcher, or we call the strainer. So after a while, the canvas becomes loose. When it becomes loose, the paint starts to become fugitive and starts to fall off. So restorers will then re-stretch the canvas and make it tight again so that the paint stays. So that's what we call relining. And in this particular case, that's painted on wood. So you don't have to, obviously, because the paint is expanding and contracting at the same quotient as the wood. But this one, the portrait of the lawyer, was never relined.
No, it's loose.
So it's a little loose. You see how the canvas is a little loose there?
Yeah.
And that's, by the way, relining it is part of conservation. It does not hurt. If anything, the theory is that it improves because it will stand the test of time a little better. And then we're going to show you masterpiece. In the folk world, folk art world, this particular artist is king right now. This was done by a fellow in Hampton, Connecticut, which is up near, just past Willimantic, Connecticut, and that was done by, his name was John Brewster Jr. John Brewster Jr. was a deaf mute, and he was taught how to paint portraiture by a gentleman who did portraits in Hartford, Reverend Joseph Stewart. And Joseph Stewart actually had his studio in the Hartford State House. And you could go there and you could have your portrait done. Joseph Stewart meets a family, their son is a deaf mute. He said, I can teach him to paint. He'll be able to make a living. He'll be able to be independent. So he teaches John Brewster Jr. how to do portraiture. Only there's something about John Brewster portraits that is so special that nobody seems to quite capture, except maybe him. Maybe because he was a deaf mute, there's a book written about him recently that he captured the personality of the sitter so well that it's like he knew them, and through his paintbrush, he could make you feel, you could look in their eyes. It's almost ethereal. It's amazing. And that's why John Brewster portraits are so highly sought after today. This one happens to be the earliest signed and dated one. And it's written on the back. And this was relined, but it was relined on clear fiberglass so that the signature will never disappear. And it says, painted by John Brewster Jr., I think it's July 1796. The earliest known portrait by him. And so when you come up and you look at him, and you're welcome to, that can be prized by any museum in the country who's interested in the folk world. She is a classic example of a New England lady with her bonnet and her beautiful turquoise dress, string of gold beads, from Hampton, Connecticut, farming town. Probably he might have charged $10 for this portrait. But it has stood the test of time. In fact, it gets better. John Brewster was discovered as a folk artist probably in the early 50s. And I would guess that maybe there are maybe 150 portraits known by him. And he eventually moved to Maine to live with his brother. And Kate, who lives in the back, works for us, her mom is curator of a museum in Saco, Maine, where John Brewster moved to. And they have the largest private collection of Brewster portraits. It's a small museum with probably, what, 6 or 8? Maybe 10 portraits?
Yeah, I'd say 10 or 12.
That it's like a gold mine in this in this one building. Some of his portraits are worth, could be worth $1 million each. And so this one isn't, but certainly it's a very highly prized portrait. And we just thought it would be good to show you this today, a masterpiece of American folk art. It doesn't come any better.
Now, how much are you selling that for?
It's not for sale.
Oh, it isn't.
it belongs in a private collection. Yeah, you could take the arms off the people. They would rather give those up than the portrait. Okay, then we're going to do stands. These are, you know, think of, we just recently had a snowstorm and a couple of storms in the fall, and a lot of us were out of power for 5-6 days. They didn't just switch on a light. They had light stands. We call these one draw stands. They lived in the dark, really. It's always amazing me what they accomplished living in the dark. Of course, they started their day at daybreak, and by 8 o'clock at night, they were going to sleep. But these stands were pretty prominently around houses, and they would bring their light and lamps, their candlesticks, and travel around, put these little light sources wherever they went. And so these are pretty common. So this is the good, the better, and the masterpiece, or in stock. So this is a nice one. It was probably made around 1820. It has a really cool top, but the legs are a little provincial. And why do we have this in our inventory? Because it has wonderful wood on the top. It's very graceful. It's sort of charming in its own way. It has a draw. It accomplishes what they wanted. It has a beautiful old collar. And not everybody can afford the great or the masterpiece. So this is a really nice example. And it's not going to really break the bank for anybody. But it really accomplishes exactly what all three of these do. Only this one's a little better, and that one's way better. So this is the Chevrolet. And go ahead, Kev. You can talk about the next two.
Oh, great. The stand in the center here has, of course, this real obvious, you know, bright headlight on the front is a Battersea enamel brass, and that's the original to the table. It's in very good condition. Has a bird's eye maple drawer front, figured maple top, mahogany cross banding, figured maple legs. It's a really nice choice of wood. Probably made in the Boston or North Shore area of Massachusetts. I don't know if you're familiar with the workshop of John and Thomas Seymour of Boston, and they also used Battersea enamel hardware on a few of their most important secretaries. This we haven't attributed to the Seymour shop, but it's certainly made by a cabinet maker working on the same level of their craftsmanship. And then again, that comparative looking. If you look at the subtleties of the swell, the tapering of those legs, compare it to this, you know, straight, you know, interesting leg with an interesting turned foot. But how much more visually exciting is this wonderful gentle swell to the leg going down, you know, swelling out and then going down to taper to that nice ankle ring, and then those kind of again swelled and tapered feet. Just nice subtleties, but again, really influenced by classical proportions and classical designs. You know, very much like a a column of antiquity, transformed into the legs. On the sides here, you can see that wonderful piece of bird's eye maple flanked by the mahogany or walnut cross banding. They pay great attention to detail and then condition. And that is just perfectly clean, very pristine underneath, and just retains all the good qualities and conditions that you'd like to see in a stand.
Excuse for the momentary interruption.
Our guest wants a Dallas moment.
Didn't want to be bypassed.
Yeah, right, exactly. A little jealous of the one door stand.
Yes.
The crack bottom of the drawer doesn't matter then?
The crack?
Yeah.
Okay, the crack is actually good.
Okay.
Because what that shows is, as you pass it around, you'll see there's a crack right down the middle of the bottom of the drawer. As I explained, everything expands and contracts. As I use the analogy, the New London Bridge, the Brooklyn Bridge, at all, that great steel expands and contracts. They have expansion joints. So when that drawer was assembled, the sides were nailed. So it's going to crack at the weak spot being the center of the drawer. So what happens is, as the wood dries, and that table is probably made around 1810. It's 200 years old. That wood, and wood is, what does it say, 90% water. As it dries, that wood shrinks and it has to crack somewhere. And so it cracked at the weak spot, wherever that weak spot might be. And that, in that case, is in the center. If we didn't see a little shrinkage somewhere, that's a sign that something has to be studied further. Is there a reason why it didn't crack? And there's sometimes the nails were relieved and re-nailed. So it has to be expansion and contraction somewhere. So that is actually a good sign. We like to see that.
Even if it were on the top of the tape?
Yeah. And sometimes it's on the top.
Yeah.
And on this one, you don't see a crack because it's actually loose. There is actually a sort of a dado, and this piece of wood, 3 o'clock, actually slides in, and so it's not nailed. It only has one nail right here. The whole drawer is only held together one nail. That's to keep the board from sliding out the back. But it has room for it to expand and contract. In that case, he nailed it. And so it had to crack. It's a different method of construction. And a lot of people will say, well, this is better. Why didn't he or that shop figure that out? Well, they had other reasons why they were doing it that way. Because whoever made this table
was really good.
I mean, they knew the laws of construction, but for some reason, they chose to do it that way. Same thing as this one. But as you go around, you will see in our shop that there are pieces with pretty good sizable cracks. This high boy right here has a crack right down the whole length of it. Same thing. That one board had to expand and contract. It was nailed, this molding is nailed right to it. So it could, and the grain goes horizontal, this board goes vertical, they're going in different directions. Something had to give. So it gave right here at the weak spot, right in the middle, just like the bottom of the drawer. And you know something, you'll find that in houses, new houses, old houses, doesn't matter. You get expansion and contraction of wood. Doors jam up in August, but in January with hot air or heat, you know, the drawers and the doors start to work better again.
And some people like to call those cracks. We prefer to call them beauty marks. Because it really is the integrity of the age of the piece. It really is a testament to the correct age and the correct aging process that each of these antiques has to go through.
Go ahead, yeah, watch this.
All right. So this little stand here, as opposed to the other two that are made out of hardwood, this is made out of pine, and then painted by a schoolgirl, probably at the North Shore of Massachusetts or Southern Maine. And she has this wonderful classical scene on top with the castle, ideally sitting up on the hill in the distance. In the front, a little more seen, a little more closer to home, with the nice colonial house and a stream and a bridge. The side panels are two of my favorites. On this side, you have a scene of mom out in the yard with a rake and a basket, raking up leaves, picking potatoes. And then on the other side, you have the scene of dad with his axe over his shoulder and the grindstone in the front yard. You know, very typical New England scene, wonderful house. And then this great border that goes all the way around the table, featuring seashells, coral, sand dollars, all on a seaweed backdrop. And the quality and the delicacy of the painting here is really exquisite. And then you get to the condition. It's a beautiful, untouched condition. You can see where there was just one coat of varnish that was put over the paint after the piece was finished, and then it was never touched again throughout its life. Great graduation of color down to the foot, where there's a little bit more wear, and it gets a little darker at the bottom of the legs. It just, you can't reproduce that. That is just a pure sign of age and a pure sign of quality. Schoolgirl work in itself has a great following. People collect needleworks, paperwork, furniture, so that has its own little market, its own little secret following.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, the great fitted drawer for the schoolgirl needlework, where she would keep her thread and her silk and her little pieces of needlework in process. And one thing that's interesting, if you come up afterwards and look, this is a photocopy of a needlework from Salem, Massachusetts, dated 1793. And very typical of this school of needlework, you get these little triangle serrated border going around the edge of the needlework. And this table also has that serrated border going around the fields of decoration. So a direct relationship between the schoolgirl painting and the schoolgirl needlework. And really an exceptional table. And kind of a lot of times these best and these masterpieces really weave together that multiple levels of interest that really make it stand up.
It has the feeling of a sample.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Yeah. And the schoolgirls would do little theorems with just the seashells and the seaweed. So this is taking needlework, theorem painting, and putting it all together. A representational landscape painting, which was very new in America at this time, in the 18th century. It was really a burgeoning idea that you could paint landscapes and representational scenes.
Our first program that we did last year, we answered the question, how do we know it's old? And one of the things that this little stand has something interesting, because we do a lot of forensic science when we try to determine the age of something. So if you're going to pick this up and move it from room to room or from one side of the room to the other to get more light on whatever you were doing, and you had your candlestick on it, you know, you'd sort of pick it up like this, right? And you just sort of set it down. Well, this is an interesting little thing here. If you pick it up, your fingers are actually right here. So you see there's a little bit of scratching right here? But there's more here. Why is that? Most people are writing. This is actually corresponds to your right hand. So my fingernails actually
dig in right there more, and I'm writing. So when we started to figure out what are those scratches, I thought, oh my God, the person had to be, for the most part, who moved this thing around had to be righty. And so they automatically are taking more of the weight, even though this thing weighs maybe 2.5 pounds. It just weighs nothing. You're welcome to come up here and really touch these things, and you know, you can go ahead, just try it, and you'll see that if they were going to move this from side to side, room to room, those little fingernails would dig in just a little bit more. And those are the things we look for, believe it or not. Kevin, beauty mark. That's because it makes our job easier to figure out, you know, is it real? You know, is it really real what it's supposed to be? Yes?
I'm assuming that was sort of purchased as an inexpensive table that someone in the family painted versus painted it and then it was sold after it was painted?
We don't know who did it. Unfortunately, whoever did it didn't write on it, you know, painted by Susie Brown in, you know, 1817, because that would be fantastic if that had occurred. We think actually that it was done by the teacher, because it's so professionally done, so well done, that we don't think one of the students would have done it. You know, the teacher was showing the students, you know, this is what you want to accomplish today. And so the stand itself is, if this paint was not on this stand is worth $100, maybe. But the stand today is priceless. It actually is as good as exists. There was a recent book on painted furniture written. The guy said to us, I wish you had found this because it would have been a highlight of the book. And we found it just too late for the book. But the paint is priceless. It literally is priceless. And two major museums are interested in it if they could come up with the money. So we really do think it was the teacher, the instructor.
But we do also believe this table was made to be painted with schoolgirl decoration.
Right.
This was pine. There's plenty of hardwood. They could have made them out of maple or cherry. But this was made to be painted by the schoolgirl. The fitted interior that relates to the needlework idea relates to the whole table.
That was more of a sort of a do-it-yourself type of thing where people would buy it and someone would paint
it. These schoolgirl finishing academies often had connections to community professionals, that some of the professionals would help paint the faces on the needlework morning scenes. This was probably, the table was commissioned by a local cabinet maker for use at the school, to be completed at the school. So there was a direct connection there. It wasn't a white table that someone decided they would decorate.
The schoolgirls were taught calligraphy, needlework, painting, the finities of life, if their parents were wealthy enough to send them to these schools. And so if this was done by a student, you know, the whole thing about a caste system, there was definitely a caste system in the 18th century. And, you know, you did not mix with the riffraff. If you were at that top level, and the wealthy people in Philadelphia and Boston and New York, they sort of had these young ladies program who they were going to meet and who they were going to marry. And this was all part of it. They had to learn, you know, how to set the table. They had to, you know how to do the proper needlework and calligraphy. And so we're just going to do pipe boxes. The pipe box is a really fascinating thing. And it's one of the most faked things of all, because it doesn't take a really good cabinet maker to make a six-sided box. It's just very simple, and in the 18th century, they would smoke these long pipes, and they would actually rent these at taverns for like a penny a night with the tobacco, and then the next day they would break off the end and rent it to the next person. And they knew enough about sanitation and hygiene that they knew that, you know, you didn't want the next person to be smoking the pipe from the other guy. So they would break off the tips, and then we've seen them down, used down to here. So they could rent this pipe 20 times. It's just a little clay pipe. And so they had these pipe boxes. That's what they're called. And the tobacco would, you know, be in the draw, maybe their kindling. And so pipe boxes were very popular, and they came in a lot of different forms. And so we have good, better, best, and masterpiece. This is probably the good. See how tall and slender it is? There, getting back to what I said about the models on the runway. You know, if it was, if you saw this one without those simulated draws without all this, it would be sort of squatty. But that one is very elegant, really wonderful design. And if you look at this, there's a bell on top. Sort of an interesting little design. Yep. There's, again, the form, which we stressed early on, which to us is the most important. The form would be really tall and elegant, the design at the top, the scrolling on the sides, and it's made out of mahogany. So that was an expensive little box when it was made. It's not, probably a little better than this one, but this one is local, it's cherry. And my father wrote on it, from the Nehemiah Hubbard family, Middletown, Connecticut, 1765. So we know who owned it, when they owned it, and that's all adds to the provenance. And then this one is probably best, because look at the beautiful scrolling on the sides. It just had, it has an older color. It's very similar to the other one, but look at, they used these little brass finials, and when they were shiny, it would be like little headlights up there. Just a little bit more elegant. But then for the granddaddy, and this is where we're going to end our talk, because this is one of the greatest icons of American furniture ever found. Probably made in Pomfret, Connecticut, by a fellow by the name of David Goodale, who was a really amazingly good cabinet maker, working up in this little town of Pomfret, Connecticut. That was so, he just had it. We have seen bureaus made by him, we've seen tables made by him, clock cases. He just had it. He just had that little extra about him that just went over the top. And there's a really wonderful document here that Kevin blew. When my father first found this in 1959. And he actually bought it in Stonington from a member of the family from Pomfret, Connecticut. And he got in touch with Henry Flint, who owned Deerfield at the time and was restoring historic Deerfield, all these great antiques. And Henry Flint, somebody told my father that he should approach Henry Flint about the pipe box, which most people who collect think that that is the best pipe box in America. That's the best one known to exist.
See you guys later.
So my father gets it up to Henry Flint up in Deerfield, and for him to think about. And it was $500 at the time, which was a fortune in 1959. Mm-hmm. So Henry Flint writes back to my father, have been expecting you to pick up the pipe box, which I do not care to purchase. If you prefer, I will ship it to you by mail or express. Let me know. Best regards, Henry Flint. It was $500. Today, it's priceless, literally priceless. And so that shows how values, and that's how we're gonna end, because the value of $500, today, it's really priceless. And because the day this guy got up, David Goodale probably really decided to do something incredibly special that day. Maybe somebody specially ordered it. Maybe he was making it for himself, but he just didn't know what else to do. He's got sunbursts,
hearts,
pinwheels. I mean, it's really an amazing piece of creativity, but it's all balanced. It's not over the top. It's not, you know, overcooked. It's not overdone. It's just showing what he could really do on that day. And so it made that much difference. So that's it. Good, better, best. Yes?
What are the different, some of the price points of the other brand? I know this is priceless, so
This one just is $4,500. That's a really nice example, very nice example. And pie foxes, every good collector of early American furniture will always want at least one pie fox in their house because it was iconic. It was every house had them from, you know, just a simple little box to a special one, sort of like what this one is. But then there's the masterpiece. And when Albert did his book, my father wouldn't lend that to him, the photograph for masterpiece. He said, "Nah, I don't want anybody to see it." So, as good of friends as they were, my father said, "Nah, I don't want to see it." So.
So typical.
So that's $4,500, and this one would be about $3,000. This one would probably be about $8,500, something like that.
How about the beginning?
And but they're all over the court because they're common. They're actually very common. Real ones are scarcer, but there's many, many, many fakes because everybody who graduated one course in industrial arts in high school could make a pipe box. But it's figuring out whether it's real or not. So by the way, this card was written by Henry Flint in 1959. So I'm sure a good economist could figure out what $500 was worth in today's money. I'm not a good economist. Any other questions? Thank you all for coming.